All right, I think we have, oh, look at this. We may actually get out of here on time. We won't get in trouble.
Nah, we'll see how many questions we got.
How many? So we're our last segment. Let's move the thing on to Q&A. Q&A, answers and questions.
Did it.
So does anybody have questions on the internet us?
Well, first off, we'll say ask Gordon, Brad, and Elena anything. They'll answer anything. This is your time to hit them hard with these awesome PC questions. I do have one about anything new about Vega from AMD. It sounds like everybody's upset that they're on radio silence.
They're still on track to launch this quarter. They said that yesterday at the earnings call. I mean, they haven't really said anything new since GDC, where they showed a couple of things, minor things, and pulled the whole, you know, Radeon Vega's name is going to be Radeon Vega. But they've been saying quarter two all along, and that's just where they are right now.
And
I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, Computex and E3 are right around the corner. One of those shows, I would expect.
Yeah, that came from Five Basher. He said he's hyped for Vega, but he's going to trade in his 1080 for Vega and a FreeSync monitor. Is that a good idea?
I gotta say that's compelling. You know, if it's
it depends on performance.
Well, let's assume it's 1080 to 1080 Ti. It's got to fall in between those, right? But really, that curveball is that FreeSync panel. Like,
yeah,
that's cheap enough.
Huge draw. That's a huge draw for AMD. I think that they don't charge extra for that, and if you can get out of there if you're looking to replace your monitor anyway, that would be a pretty compelling combo, I would think.
Yeah.
The thing with FreeSync as opposed to G-Sync is they only support certain ranges. So just do your research and make sure that the supported ranges of frame rates are inside the frame rates of what you're looking to play at.
So we got another question from Sam Ritta on Facebook. It's a little bit general. Is AMD better than Intel?
At graphics? Yeah, that's easy. That one's pretty easy. Graphics, way better.
I feel like we've had this discussion many times so far on the show in recent months.
If we're talking x86 side, you know, it kind of depends. There is pluses and minuses of both the platform. You have to, you don't listen to us, you know, read our reviews, read other people's reviews, you know, decide what your needs are. Do you need more cores, more threads? AMD definitely gives you that. You need a crap load more PCIe lanes. You're only going to really get that out of sort of high-end Intel right now. You really need high IPC, high clock speed. That's still KB Lake. So go on what your needs are. Don't go by what people on the internet tell you. Which I just told you on the internet.
Good life advice.
So here's a good one for Elena from Thomas on YouTube. What's the best tablet lightweight laptop that I can travel with and use Ableton Live 9 on?
And use what?
Ableton Live 9.
I don't actually know what that is.
Oh, it's a music production.
So is it a Windows app or Android? I am guessing.
No, it's Windows. Yeah.
Oh, Windows. So.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, how system intensive is that particular program? I'm not familiar with it.
Well, it depends. You like load up a bunch of audio loops, and it's, I mean, as intensive as any of the other audio programs. Doesn't the guy in the testing lab, doesn't he load up Ableton?
Yeah, I got to say, I didn't find it to be super thread heavy. So, and then, you know, frankly, it's mobile. We're talking AMD anyway, or we're talking Intel anyway. So, I mean, you really want the most powerful tablet you can get.
Yeah, I'm wondering, like, the tablet sounds like they're looking for something that's just lightweight, easy to carry.
Yeah, I think he means a little more, like, convertible, maybe.
I mean, yeah. There's actually a lot of good options out there right now. It just depends on the price point, you know, how much you want to spend. Because obviously the lighter you go, the more you're going to start paying for performance. So if you want to kind of keep that delta just in that sweet spot between all three, I'd say you're probably looking at, if you're not worried about price, probably something like Surface Pro 4, possibly one of HP's, the X2.
The one
with the kickstand. That one's getting a little older though. That's Core M, I believe. Mm-hmm. So you'll pay less. It's a little heavier, but it also has slightly lower like top end performance.
Yeah, for pure tablet, right?
Yeah, and then there's also this HP Spectre that Gordon has. That starts about $1,000, but it's 2-in-1, so you can flip it between different form factors. A little bit on the heavier side compared to something like the Surface Pro 4, because Surface Pro 4, the type cover weighs less than an actual, you know, keyboard.
You know, but I got to say, the one thing I found is like, it is actually very nice to not lose lappability.
Yeah.
To these convertibles, I mean, I really, for a long time, I thought they were useless, but I got to say, it'd be tough to go back to a Surface Pro at this point, I think, from a, these convertibles have gotten so light and so thin. I mean,
they have, but if even like a matter of ounces matter to you, as they do for me, because I try to cram everything into a single backpack when I travel, for me, I would go still with the Surface Pro 4. But if I didn't worry so much about, say, like 5 or 6 ounces, then probably I would go with the Spectre.
Okay.
Do you think a Surface Book is an alternative at all, or just too heavy?
Surface Book is so expensive.
But you're getting Surface.
I mean, do you want to pay $1,000 or $2,200?
It looks cool, man. Yeah, I know. It is interesting.
So, yeah. All right. Brad, here's one for you. RX 580 or R9 Fury X?
If you can get them for the same price, I would get the Fury X. It's going to use a lot more power. It's going to give you more performance. And it has that badass integrated water cooler. So, I mean, if you can get it for a rough, if you can find a Fury for Fury X for $250 to $300, that's pretty, at that point, I would be interested in that. It only has 4 gigabytes of RAM, but it's the faster HBM, so it's really not too much of an issue in a lot of games. But yeah, good luck finding one that price, though.
But I was wondering, so the 4 gig frame buffer doesn't kill you too much, just because it's just the bandwidth is just so much greater.
Yeah, I forget. I haven't tested it in a few months, but I wasn't having issues. Yeah, because the bandwidth was so high that it was just, even on games that use a lot of bandwidth, it just chews through it. So. Okay.
If you can
find comparable pricing, Fury X all day long. That's still actually my favorite design, the look of it, of any graphics card I've ever tested. I love that thing. It's gorgeous.
Nice. Another quick one. I think I know the answer on this. From Zemajo on YouTube. Does gaming mode in the Windows 10 update make a difference?
That's a Brad.
It's a Brad question.
Yes, this is interesting because Linus Tech Tips just put out a video saying it does not and it sucks. And that's not necessarily true because him and a lot of other testers are testing on gaming PCs. And if you have a gaming PC where you already have even a budget gaming PC, if you have a PC with a discrete graphics card, it's probably not going to make a difference to you. It might even possibly, depending on the game, push performance a little bit down, depending on how it behaves. But if you use a laptop or if you're using a gaming PC where you have stuff running in the background, which Linus didn't do in his testing, not to call him out, just saying. So like if you're running Chrome and Discord or you're playing Spotify in the background, the idea is that game mode devotes more resources to your game and less to those. So I tested it on a Surface Book with NVIDIA N65, I believe.
965
graphics. Yeah. And it made a huge difference running a YouTube video and AV in the background. Like, it made a huge difference. It doubled the minimum frame rate in that case. So it can work very, very well in budget hardware or on systems where you got a bunch of stuff running. But if you're the kind of gamer who closes everything down, maybe leaves just Discord open and plays already on good hardware, it probably won't make too much of a difference.
What about really limited hardware, like, say, a config where you've got 8 gigs or 4 gigs of RAM? I mean, that's... And
8 gigs is not limited.
Yeah, 8 is on a desktop. Well, on a desktop, 8 gigs is pretty much entry-level at this point, right? So, say 4 gigs or 6, some weird duck configuration like that. And, like, an entry-level video card.
It wouldn't make a difference with the gigs because currently it only affects CPU and GPU.
Oh, okay. So, they're not pushing processes out of the way?
Nope. They said there's going to be more improvements coming, they told us. Sounded RAM, it seems like that would make sense. But yeah, you'd think the more system constrained that you are, the more of a difference it'll have. Like if you're running on a dual core or quad core processor and you're already seeing, you know, high CPU utilization, then running this could very well mean the difference between playable and not playable. That's what I found in my Surface Book testing. So,
Well, hey, if Linus Tech Tips wants to come on the show, you know, and talk with us about it, come on, you know, you're welcome anytime for sure.
No, he does good work, but that just came out yesterday. I think that was the Genesis maybe for that question, because it was going around quite a bit. People were asking me about that on Twitter. Why is it so different? It's because we use different testing systems, right? Mm-hmm. He was just testing it in a pure gaming environment. I was testing it in a mixed environment. So that's why there's the difference.
All right. Cool. Let's do this, the last one. This kind of goes full circle from Ben 10. he came a little late. Did we say whether the Surface laptop is good for gaming or not?
No, there is an Iris Plus 640 version, which
those are only in the Core i7 ones.
In the Core i7, there's an Iris version. The other one is just pretty much a standard Kaby Lake Iris 620. I know they do call out Apple, because it's always fun to call Apple out, and they say, I think they say it's 50% faster than the MacBook Air 13, but you know, my phone is 50% faster than a MacBook Air 13 at this point. But yeah, for gaming, you know, Kaby Lake graphics and the Iris Plus one, you can get some, you know, esports class graphics at, you know, probably acceptable frame rates, you know.
Oh, hear the pain in your voice.
It's not going to be great. It's not going to be that they're not designed for gaming. I will say you probably can play some games, you know, it depends on where you're from. Like if you're running a 1080 Ti on your desktop, this is not going to be a gaming device for you. But if you're coming from integrated graphics, these will probably be better than whatever you're running right now. So.
Cool. Let's leave it with that then.
That is the last question. Look at that. We're only 5 minutes over. Actually, ooh. I think we're right. We should get an award.
Yeah.
We go over all the time. They should like give us an award for this, like free donuts.
You're not getting fired.
Yes, that's good. All right. And to see if we got fired, check back in 2 weeks for your fix of PC Talk on The Full Nerd. For audio listeners, subscribe to us on iTunes, Google Play, or Stitcher. Send questions. We really want to hear them, and I will check before the next 3-month period. And comments to thefullnerd@pcworld.com. Again, that is thefullnerd@pcworld.com. Thanks for coming. I'm Gordon Ung with co-host Brad Charkas.
Adios.
Elaine Yee.
Bye, everyone.
And Adam Patrick Murray will take us out.
Have fun or not.